afterglow of Christmas. We're still in the glow of the Christmas lights, and it is a joy, and I hope you all had a joyous Christmas holiday. And here we are in the joy of a new year. And so in the joy of this new year, let us worship God.
Good morning and Happy New Year.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Little Brown Church of Nederland.
The house of prayer amongst the peace, home to all who come.
Welcome to this gathering place.
Friend and stranger, saint and sinner, all gathered here.
Come with hope or hesitation, come with joy or yearning, all who hunger, all who thirst for life in all its fullness.
God of wonder, God of all being, may we know the Spirit.
And in knowing the Spirit, let us live from the Spirit.
God with us, Emmanuel, God in us, in me, and in you, and in everything.
If you're able, remain standing to sing What Star Is This with Being So Bright. During joys and concerns, you can write those down, and we will. I will include them in the prayers this morning. A few announcements. If you're looking at the bulletin,
and you're taking it literally. Jackson Haas is not here this morning. That's who it indicates. That's my typo. That might have been a subliminal slip. I wish I was still skiing powder in Steamboat. But I did make it back. I sent an SOS to Jim Reese and said, the meteorologists are calling for copious amounts of snow, which I never believed was going to happen. But I might have been trapped in Steamboat. So I let Jim know, but I did manage to sneak out. Other announcements. Communion is not listed. That's, again, my fault. So you can scratch it in there. Right after the Lord's Prayer, we're going to have communion. And then into the Bob Dylan tune, Don't Think Twice, It's All Right. And if you're surprised that Bob Dylan is a song this morning, you shouldn't be. Other announcements. We are going to... We didn't give you prior notice, but we are going to take down the tree after the service today. So if you can spare a few moments, if there's lots of hands, we'll take it down quickly. And then last announcement I have, and this is a couple weeks out, congregational meeting January 15th, immediately following the service, and it won't, like most congregational meetings here, won't take long. Any other announcements or additions? Yes.
What's the congregational meeting about?
The congregational meeting is about my package,
right.
So to speak, and just, adding $50,000 to it. No, I'm kidding. No, just affirming what it is. And I don't know, what. I'm sure I'll be asked to leave or something.
Just for the
meeting. Or deducted, I may be reduced, who knows. What's that, Gwen?
Also, a new elder will be installed?
We did install the fellowship elder. I think we do have the treasurer that's coming up, or finance, but that's not happening in 2 weeks. Because that's not, but that's coming up at some point. So if you're listening to this announcement right now, Mark Moll is ours as the finance elder for as long as we need him, but then we're looking for a long term. That's my understanding, correct, Jim?
Yes, and Mark Streetfellow will have to be reinstalled. Because his 3-year term is up, so he's agreed to stay on.
Okay, so maybe Mark Stringfellow will be reinstalled on January 15th. So maybe that's what you're thinking of. Any other announcements? Yes, BG.
A reminder that the new sign-up sheet for fellowship and liturgists and ushers and whatever is posted on the bulletin board by the kitchen. And there are plenty of openings. So if you feel so moved, sign up.
And as it says in the announcements on the back of your bulletin, volunteers, ! It's not because we're desperate, it's because it's so fun.
Yeah.
And it is surprisingly fun and easy. Susan Wagner has stepped into the role of liturgist occasionally. And is it fun and surprisingly easy?
It's surprisingly easy. I appreciate your relaxed. Your effort to help us not strive for perfection.
Right.
Because it really helped me a lot know that I didn't have to be perfect.
Right. Well, some of the most humorous moments at a church service are the imperfections. So, we can model grace by, not ruefully looking at the person that misspeaks or does something out of turn. So it's surprisingly fun and easy. Yes, Patty?
Just so anybody who's here will know, BG and Debbie and I are here cleaning during the week, and when we do that, we set up everything for fellowship, meaning the coffee's made, it needs to be plugged in, everything is ready on the tables. All you have to do is bring the food. So
Or pull it out of the freezer. How about making coffee?
Well, we make the coffee ahead of time.
Oh, you do?
Yes. All you have to do is plug it in.
Just plug it in.
Yeah.
Okay. Jim.
I just wanted to let some folks know some good news that we had a really good turnout of 81 people and 14 kids for the Christmas Eve service. And the Deacon's Fund, which if you don't know, the entire Christmas Eve service collection goes for the Deacon's Fund, and they collected over $1,100 to add to the Deacon's Fund to help people in our community for this.
Fantastic.
I had no idea.
Well, thanks for correcting what was in my mind, Jim. I've been telling people we had over 100 people here, because it felt like it. It was pretty full. I don't know what this church holds officially, but it felt full. So it was great.
We're pretty close, 96.
96, okay. I was rounding up. All right, well, if there are any further announcements, we're going to stand and sing a song that was requested a few years back by Frank Lutz, following Christmas, and I think this has been done for, past 5, 6, 7 years. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. I don't see any children out there. I see a lot of young in heart, but no children. Let's start with the scripture passage from Isaiah. And just by the way, and I really love when hymns we sing sort of summarize the sermon to come, and I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day sort of does that. So the passage today from Isaiah comes from chapter 63, 7 through 9, and I might expand that to 11. Listen for the word of God. I will recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, because of all that the Lord has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel, that he has shown them according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior in all their distress. It was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. But they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit. Therefore, he became their enemy. He himself fought against them. Then they remembered the days of old of Moses' servant. Where is the one who brought them up out of the sea with the shepherds of his flock? Where is the one who put within them his Holy Spirit, who caused his glorious arm to march at the right hand of Moses, who divided the waters before them to make for himself an everlasting name? The word of God. And BG has a passage for us from the Gospel of Matthew.
This is from Matthew 2:13 through 23. An angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up and take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the Magi. Then what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. This is the word of God.
Okay, well, the sermon title, as you can see in the bulletin, is Destiny. That was inspired by a poem that you'll hear from. By David White. Well, it's not a poem, it's an essay, but he is a poet. This weekend, my family and I went to Steamboat to ski, and there was lots and lots of powder. I don't know how many inches, but over a couple feet. Thursday morning, I got up early with a friend of mine who lives up there, who was a teammate at CU, and he's always stayed fitter than I am. And we skinned up to the top of Storm Peak. If you know what skins are, you put these mohair skins on the bottom of your skis and you climb. And it's like 3,600 feet to the top. We kept going. I thought we were going to get to the top where the gondola drops off and ski down. He goes, "No, now we're going to go up to 4 points." And then we went up to 4 points, and I thought I was done. "No, now we're going to go up to the top. If there would have been another top, we would have gone up there, but we went as high as we could go." But it gave us plenty of time to chat. And about three quarters of the way up the mountain, the conversation turned to health and what maximizes it. And Andy mentioned a doctor by the name of Dr. Peter Attia, a physician specializing in the science of applied longevity. And Attia will sit down with a client, could be a client who's 30 years old or 70 years old, and the earlier the better, obviously, and ask them, what their physical ability goals are for the last decade of their life. And then they figure out what they hope, and granted there's things that can happen, but what they hope is their last decade of life, and they figure out goals, and then they kind of work backwards and say, okay, if that's where you're going to live to and these are your goals, then this is what we got to do starting now. So you set your dietary and exercise routines for the next 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 years. And in so doing, creating a personal destiny. And it brings up the question, what is destiny? We began with a verse from Matthew. An angel of the Lord appears to Joseph and tells him to take his son and his wife and flee to Egypt because Herod is hunting them. So he woke up his family in the middle of the night and goes to Egypt. But he does so because of a dream, and he acts on that dream. After Herod dies, Joseph and his family return to Israel again. And again in a dream, Joseph is told, go to Galilee because it's quite dangerous down where Archelaus is, who has memories of what his father did. So they go to Galilee in a town called Nazareth. Matthew says, fulfilling the destiny of what had been spoken by the prophets, he will be called a Nazarene. So the destiny of the Christ child is dependent on the actions of his father. His destiny is not automatic, just like the destiny of our health is not automatic. It's not in the stars. Some of it might be, but most of it is not. Right? You might get something out of the blue that you have no control over, but a good percentage we have control over. Much depends on the action we take, the choices we make regarding diet, exercise regimes, before we arrive at our destiny, which is a movable destiny. The poet David White has a book of essays called Consolations. Each essay is a deep consideration of a word, and there's 52 words, and destiny happens to be one of them. This guy is delightful and wise. He's Irish and Welsh, but lives in Washington State. Here's the following are excerpts from White's destiny essay. Destiny always has a possessor, as in my destiny or your destiny. It's a word that invites belief or disbelief. Destiny grants us a sense of possibilities and gives us an intimation of our flaws. When we choose between these two poles of mythic triumph or fated failure, we may miss the everyday conversational essence of destiny. Our future influenced by the very way we hold the conversation of life itself. Never mind any actions we may take or neglect to take. Two people, simply by looking at the future in radically different ways, have completely different futures awaiting them, no matter their immediate course of action. It reminds me of metaphysics, and we change what happens at the subatomic level by just observing it. So our observation is very important. We are shaped by our shaping of the world and are shaped again in turn. The way we face the world alters the face we see in the world. Every person always lives out their destiny, no matter what they do. according to the way they shape the conversation, but that destiny may be lived out on the level of consummation or complete frustration, depending on how we're facing. It is still our destiny, our life, but the sense of the satisfaction involved and the possibility of fulfilling its promise may depend upon a brave participation, a willingness to hazard ourselves in a difficult world, a certain form of wild generosity with our gifts, a familiarity with our own depth, our own surprising breadth, and always a long and practiced, robust vulnerability, a long practiced and robust vulnerability equal to what any future may offer. So it requires a lot of us. That's the end of David White. One more thing. Our destiny is fated not only by great powers beyond our beckoning horizon, but by the very way we shape and hold the everyday conversation of a familiar life. So destiny, personal destiny, and collective destiny is not so much something that happens to us, but happens because of us. White contends that simply how we look at the future makes the future that awaits us. For most of us, to realize the destiny of a healthy and long-lived life, we must proactively take action rather than being acted upon. The Christ child needed a father to pay attention to his dreams and then take action to change the destiny of his son. If he would have ignored it and stayed in Bethlehem area, he would have been cut down along with the other children that were murdered. The passage in Isaiah is a remembrance of how life went well when the tribe of Israel listened to God and followed his ways, and how life fell to pieces when they rebelled. Our ultimate personal destiny that matters, and I listed a few that seem to matter: peace of mind, loving relationships with our family and friends, and we only hold one side of this conversation, a good name that people respect, how we are remembered after we pass on from these bodies. All of this is determined by our choices, our daily conversations, how we face the world, and the source of wisdom that we listen to. Our collective destiny that matters is the world that we pass to future generations, such as the health of the planet, the health of the culture that we create and perpetuate as society, is determined by our choices and daily conversations, how we face the world, and the source of wisdom that we listen to. In this new year of 2023, a time of resolution for so many, ask yourself quietly, how will I face the world in 2023? How will I shape the conversation that's every day, that's happening in front of me? Will I live out my destiny in consummation or in frustration? Our destiny can be, and I believe this, can be joy no matter what comes, when we include in our conversation something much bigger, something much more profound something much more joyous and life-giving that informs and shapes our daily conversation. And so I leave you with this, in this new year, in your own way, not in the way of someone else, according to your own personal gifts and personality. I think of this because when I talk to Lydia about how we embody ourselves, Lydia says, well, I'm just not that effervescent, bubbly person, and no one is asking her to be, or you, and maybe you are like that. Be that in spades. But whatever your personality, your personal gifts, may you choose the irrepressible destiny of joy, the way of God, the way of Christ, for all the world. And not only for you, but for those you love and care for. Amen.
Amen.
And we will follow that message with the hymn from the blue hymnal, Brightest and Best of the Stars of the Morning, 67.
The offering plate, and as we do, please know how grateful the church is for all the generosity of time and resources and talents that so many give to make this community happy and thrive. Will the ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
O God, inspired by grace, with the spirit of gratitude, we give a measure of our treasures, and through this giving, may this community be a vibrant expression of grace in and for the community of Nederland and for all the world. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Christ, all creatures here below. Praise the Holy Spirit evermore. Praise the Him, God, whom we adore. Amen.
You may be seated. Now we'll take the moment to hear and pray for our joys and concerns. Do you have any joys? This morning I have joys on one side and concerns on the other. It's a joy to have a new year here, and so far good news with lots of snow and people in the church happy and smiling. Yes, Dean.
I'm just going to live Christmas. My mom, who's 93, I brought her out, and she stayed a week, and she hadn't been out here for 5 years. She was worried about altitude, but she actually did much better than some of my daughter's family who live in Denver. They always can't sleep the first night.
Oh, really?
Mom was great, and we had a good Christmas. And I also, I guess this is a joy concern thing, my brother-in-law, Jim Parker, only 63, had a heart valve replacement last Wednesday, and he's out of the hospital and went home, but prayers for his continued recovery.
And we'll keep Jim in our prayers. Thanks for mentioning that. And what is your mother's name?
Molly. She loved the Christmas Eve.
Oh, good. Where is she up from?
Bergen and West.
That's right. I knew that. Other joys and concerns? Yes.
Yeah. Just thanks for all the prayers from my brother Jack. Yeah. Two or three days before Christmas is when he had his stroke, and he was in rehab, and on Christmas Day he started vomiting blood. So they took him back to the hospital, ran a myriad of tests, kind of like I said, in the and maybe traces of or early signs of pneumonia, but the good news is that he's doing well, and he's back in rehab. So everything's good. They're expecting maybe a release as early as January 8th.
We will pray for Jack this morning, and that is, I said that is, given the circumstances, good news.
Good news, yes.
So we will keep him in our prayers. Thanks for mentioning. Other joys or concerns? Yes, PJ.
A joy for all of those who travel safely over the holidays and who will travel again this week. We traveled to Tennessee to see Patty's mom, who is 97, and she is in good health and getting along very well, and we're very grateful for that.
And Patty says that Memphis has not changed and will never change. What's that? It will not, it will never change. There's the good and the bad of that.
We got a soul-searching sermon on Christmas Eve. Not expected. We expected something else, but it was fire and brimstone as we loved and learned to love as children.
That's part of the it'll never change. If you ever need fire and brimstone, you got Memphis. Let us pray. God, we give thanks for all the people in this room and all the experiences that were had over the Christmas holidays, and most of it, we trust, joyful and full of light and wonder and celebration. It certainly was so on Christmas Eve in this sanctuary. But also we pray in those instances where things were difficult and strained, perhaps with family members that didn't see eye to eye, or for those that maybe heard a fire and brimstone sermon that didn't quite land. We pray this morning for Jim Parker in his recovery with his heart valve, that his body would receive that valve and integrate it into the heart, and he would have many more years of a heart that pumps and gives life to his body. And we pray for Brother Jack, who suffered a stroke and might be dealing with an early stage of pneumonia. We pray for his caretakers. We also just pray, most importantly, for his peace of mind and his peace of soul as he faces probably one of the most trying times and moments of his life. We give thanks for his family that surrounds him. And we give thanks for family that is long-lived, such as Dean has and his mother, Molly. We do give thanks for Dean's mother being here on Christmas Eve, along with his daughter, and that it was a joyous and healthy experience up here at 8,000 feet. And we pray for all those traveling still with travels to come or heading down to Boulder or Denver this week as the snow comes. We pray for all of these things and all the things that go unspoken. We pray with the words that Christ taught his first friends. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
And do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now, this is the part of the service that's not mentioned. If you just excuse me, this seems very Catholic of me to wash my hands. this is not listed, but we have communion, and then we will have our song of sending. And could I get a couple of ushers to come up and help with the communion after the words of institution? Well, we often speak of the fellowship hour, we just pull things out of the freezer. Well, this week, your communion bread was baked by me and cut up and put in the freezer and pulled out this morning. And so it's fresh and ready to go. I suspect the bread that Christ took was not frozen and taken out and thawed. But he did take bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." And the words that he was speaking is very connected to the words we read in Scripture today. This is your destiny. If you choose to hear these words and to take the bread and to eat it and to do likewise for all the world, because you are my disciples, to go out into the world with the same spirit that enlivens me. And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This is my lifeblood poured out for all of you. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. The gifts of God for all the people of God. Amen. Please come. Stand and join in singing Don't Think Twice, It's All Right.
Thank you.
song that maybe doesn't immediately strike you, but you can go away with your print out there with only some of the verses and think about what Bob Dylan was trying to tell us. But this morning, take this: when we put ourselves in God's hands and we face towards the face of the Spirit, we don't have to think twice, because it is all right. And all the people said,
amen.
Go in peace. And stay and help with the Christmas tree if you have time. And if you don't think twice.
And we can leave the box.
Thank you.